The heat had become oppressive. Numerous rabbits had left their burrow in search of food. For Paraji the dingo and his pack, the hunt had never been so fruitful. Artui, the leader of the camels, had accepted that Marhali, who had been cut off from the group, could take his dust bath in the proximity of the herd. This was the time when the brown snakes executed their ruthless battles, the trophy being a female. On Kangaroo Island, Pogo didn't understand why his mother, Kartania, had neglected him. Nagama could not wait any longer for the female to surrender to him. All this Paraji projected on the Dome of Dreams. For it is in this way we enter life when our dream begins. While the dryness shriveled up the center of the continent, there was one watering hole left, somewhere in the bush. Now, this is already nothing more than a pond. Not even a pool, but a simple puddle, embedded in the middle of the dry earth. Some wandering dingoes, their sides ribbed from hunger and thirst, have found it, and have come to drink. The arrival of some thirsty horses bothers the weakened dingoes, who could be killed by a kick from their hooves. The horses are Brumbies. We call their descendants this, who were imported during the time of the pioneers, that's to say from 1788 on. Having become wild again, their numbers now exceed 300,000 in the country. The dingoes are patient and let the horses invade the watering hole. In principle, the horses won't linger very long. A rule of the desert requires that one drink rapidly in order to prevent an adversary from taking advantage of this moment's vulnerability. And even those that don't have any other predators except man in this country respect this law. It has been engraved from their origins in the deepest, most secret parts of their brains. For the Brumbies, the dingoes, and others, water is coveted. Australia is the driest continent in the world, if one doesn't consider the ice desert which forms Antarctica. The last continent receives an average of 1.5 feet of water per year. But Tasmania and the tropical regions of the north absorb the main part of it. Only a small part of it remains for the desert, and of that, only 12% doesn't evaporate, thereby contributing in satisfying the needs of the flora and fauna. One group follows another. At present, it's some dromedaries who appropriate the watering hole. A camel can go without drinking for 17 days. True, his metabolism permits him to transform the 80 pounds of fat in his hump and to obtain the equivalent of 10 gallons of water. But in reality, this fat serves also to supply him with nourishment that he is missing. If the camel is dry, it's because his needs, compared to those of other species, are infinitely less. Deprived of water in a torrid climate, a man dies when his weight diminishes by 12%. Under the same conditions, a dromedary can lose 25% of his weight and survive. That means he can tolerate extremely well having just a bit of water in his body. The camels have rapidly quenched their thirst before the Brumbies, who move away. Each of them can absorb more than 34 gallons of water in around 10 minutes. It's possible that the delight of having enough to drink brings about with some an enthusiasm and demonstrative euphoria, a sort of drunkenness. The sun goes down, and its decline makes the heat more tolerable. Anyway, this doesn't hurt the fauna as much as the dryness. Even if the temperatures rise, they are not as high as in the summer, the period where they exceed 115 degrees. It's the general dryness that has come with winter that makes life almost unbearable until the night of copper and gold arrives. On Kangaroo Island, where Burka, Kartanya, Pogo, and the clan of gray kangaroos live in the south, the ocean moderates the climate all year long. In Australia, the words which describe the seasons have not the same meaning as elsewhere. When one says summer, it's necessary to understand the wet season, or the wet. Winter means the dry season, or the dry. And in order to complicate everything, the seasons are in reverse relative to the Northern Hemisphere. January, for example, is a summer month, and July is situated in the dead of winter. Under the watch of those who sleep or bustle about at all hours, like the eastern gray kangaroo, or the tamar wallaby, the freshness of the night beckons them outside of their nest, these creatures of the shadows. Among them, the common ringtail possum, who belongs to the family of opossums, is characterized by his tail, which is prehensile, like a fifth limb. It aids him in hanging onto branches, in climbing, or descending the length of trunks, and sometimes in manipulating twigs from which he makes his nest. The common ringtail possum, the tamar wallaby. The common brushtail possum. or the southern brown bandicoot are all marsupials. It's to them that the Australian night really belongs. They have in common being born incomplete and are required to take refuge from birth in the pouch of the females located on their stomach. There they pursue their development attached to the teat of their mother for several weeks, indeed, several months. Perched on its tree, the common brush-tailed possum, called this because of its bushy tail, is present at the meal of a southern brown bandicoot. As with all nocturnal animals, the common brush-tailed possum has adapted himself to obscurity. The surface of his nose is rich in nerve endings. There, the long hairs are located from one part of the snout to the other, offering him, in a way, a vision. A touch-sensitive display for his environment. His globular eyes are sensitive to the more minute quantities of light, like his ears are. Thanks to the large housings that could hear the slightest noise brought about, for example, by some eastern gray kangaroos busy getting their strength before playing. The quarrel makes the wallabies disperse. It will take more than that to extinguish the enthusiasm of the kangaroos. In the history of evolution, the nocturnal activity of animals is tied to their need to protect themselves from predators. But predators, like the barking owl, have developed in their turn sensory abilities which make them able to live in the evening shade. That made a long battle that still endures between a virtue and an ability. Discretion against detection. The common ringtail possum leads an arboreal life. It likes to nest in the hollow of a dead tree or a scooped-out stump. It doesn't go out until the night in order to attack an onslaught of eucalyptus flowers, which it loves making a delicious meal out of. The common ringtail possum benefits from teeth that grind up the leaves and flowers, and from intestinal bacteria that aid in the assimilation of fibers. And in order to be more efficient, the excrement is often reabsorbed and redigested. In the Great Red Desert, no rain has fallen for such a long time. The wind picks up. It's a burning and dry wind, like the air that escapes from an open oven. Waka, Paraji's daughter, is irritated by the wind blowing through her fur. A little further away, her father must face gusts of wind. Paraji, Kintala, and Waka no longer know which odor to go by. The whirlwind intermingles the scents and tangles the nasal tracts, creating a chaos wherein the nostrils are lost. The dingoes are suddenly incapable of interpreting information that supplies their senses, the most developed of which is the sense of smell. Thank you. Kira, the dominant female, still seems capable of resisting the mirages of sense. Little by little, the storm loses its breath and its strength. The first will come back soon. It's a part of these winds that never let go and will join itself to the trade winds. These will sweep across the arid zones and remove from the soil any water that evaporation had not yet transformed into vapor. They drain the least bit of perspiration from the ground. These winds are insatiable. We find them all over the world. They are called ferns, churges, chiracos. On the blue enamel of the South Australian basin, the chiseled coasts of Kangaroo Island stand out. This night, Cartagena has been impregnated. For several weeks, two males have fought over her favors, Kudla, so weak, and Nagama, so powerful. Pogo, Cartagena's son, sleeps. Perhaps he has seen nothing. Kudla, the young rejected male, comes to smell the female and discovers that it's too late. He will not have her. The arrival of Nagama has forced him to run off. He'll brood over his humiliation somewhere else than under the eyes of the victor. Nagama, Cartagena and Pogo form a new family unit. A bird takes off and lands on a dead branch. He inspects the landscape. Then, once again, he lands on the ground. He seems lost. Such is the strategy of the Crimson Chat in order to confirm the absence of all predators before returning the delicacy in its bill to the nest where its babies await. The delicacy is a worm or a caterpillar. The babies would also just as well accept a fly or a seed. It's their mother's turn for the moment to provide for them. When she arrives, the male has already left again for the hunt. By two, they form a kind of shuttle and relay in order that they never stop the inflow necessary for the feeding of the babies. The male has come back. The appetite of his offspring is a fire upon which it is necessary to throw water nonstop. With the Crimson Chats, the male distinguishes himself by a most vivid color, an indispensable scarlet if he wants to hope to seduce a female. She adopts a discreet appearance and is more pale, a light orangey color. The nest has an appearance of a simple bowl dug into the soil, where it's fashioned with the assistance of dried grass and twigs. In this time of reproduction, the Crimson Chat therefore spends a great part of his time walking or running more than he hops, even on the ground. Sometimes he can run the risk of meeting thieves less edible than a spider. For the two skin-and-bone dingoes who wander in the vicinity, the crimson chat and its family would make a meal for a king in these times of shortage, where one puts up with having little. But they pass by on their way without having detected the birds. In normal times, when food is abundant, the dingoes can go without drinking for several days. This is possible by satisfying their needs thanks to the water contained in the body of their prey. Dingoes can be traced for more than 80 miles from a source or a pond. But when they are lacking food, the dryness becomes deadly. Dingoes are obliged to lick the urine and excrement of their fellow dingoes in order to recycle moisture. But even this does not suffice. They must kill so that a prey gives all the water in its blood at the same time as its life. One of the dingoes passing by has found a burrow where it sees the fidgeting of a living thing. A rat or a snake who has taken refuge in its burrow would make him happy. It wasn't either, but an insect, which will have to do. The two dingoes move away. Perhaps they will survive. The desert, in any case, will not help them. A tail two times longer than the body. A skin the color of earth. Fingers and claws of an unskilled worker. A throat that can stand on end in case of danger and form a sort of beard. Edges that stand on end. Scales that protect the eyes from projections of sand when the animal digs a burrow. Acrobatic talents mastered badly enough. Such is the Western bearded dragon, attentive observer of life in the desert. Marhali, the camel who begs and wanted to be part of Artui's herd, has not been admitted for more than some days. He had already appropriated some females and taken them with him in order to form his own harem. Female has been stolen from Artui, then another, and another still. The exploit, nevertheless, has not been accomplished without a fight. But Marhali had a vigor which for a long time was concealed. Today, he gathers his strength and feels reborn, in the same manner that his body renews the patches of the wool on his back. The distrustful brown snake slides on the surface of the desert. His fangs inject into his victims a neurotoxic poison of extreme power. He is looking for an inhabited burrow that he could run through in order to steal a life, or a nest populated by some cheeping and terrified prey. The two crimson chats land on a branch in order to relay the task of provisions and don't see anything coming. As usual, the male deposits a larva, a fly, or a seed in one of the wide-open gullets under his beak. Then the female comes for her turn to nourish the babies. The brown snake approaches. All of his sensorial captors are on alert. They have located a heat source, some noise, and smells. The male crimson chat has understood that an enemy wants to attack his family. Bravely, he faces his adversary. The little cries of the bird draw the serpent towards the side. The female comes to comfort him. The brown snake no longer knows which direction to make his body undulate. The two birds fly above him ostensibly and land in front of him, relaying themselves in order to move him away from the nest. The tactic seems to bear fruit, but suddenly the crimson chats panic. The serpent has made a half turn. The reptile has reached a good bush. The baby birds are in his reach. The father remains dumbfounded. He can do nothing. The female, on the other hand, starts to flutter about, cheep, and gesticulate in order to turn the snake around. The snake seems to prefer the hope of a meal to the certitude of a meal that he had come so close to getting. He follows the female. The male comes to add to the confusion created in the mind of the snake by fluttering about. Of the bird or its companion, the reptile doesn't know which will be the most delicious. He hesitates between one and the other, and finishes invariably by following the one who moves the most. In spite of the skill of the birds, the brown snake stays in the vicinity. It is necessary to call upon the most depraved cunning. The female adopts a strategy of having worn out wings, pretending to be crippled in order to entice the predator as far away as possible. Tricked by the bird, the brown snake will not rediscover the way which takes him to the nest. All is back in place. The birds can recommence their incessant rounds. Certain plants of the desert are to the Australian flora like the dromedaries are to the fauna. They are so adapted to life in a dry place. The dingo has not succeeded as well. He who descends from the gray wolf of the Orient, used to the forests and the wet climate of Southeast Asia. Paraji has been separated from his own. He left on a scouting mission to search for a watering hole. He was hoping to find a trunk where a little mud might be lapped up. But around him, he sees nothing except dry land, which is covered in cracks and from where nothing seeps. The volume of water absorbed by the soil in a country such as the United States is 16 times greater than that which we see in Australia. And in the desert, the average dryness doesn't compare to that of the Sahara. As in Death Valley, the layers of evaporated water are spread out on the ground, here and there, a mineral crust. Paraji, whose paws are aching and can no longer stand on the burning ground, has laid down. But the hot air continues to dry him, his mucus, and his respiratory tracts. A column of fire has entered in his body and doesn't want to leave anymore. It is only 95 degrees, but the absence of all wetness produces the same sensation as if it were 150 degrees. Paraji would like to get going, but his weakness doesn't let him. He staggers for a minute and lays down again, buried under a sheet of embers. Paraji doesn't know it, but around 7 miles from there, the grass has still conserved a bit of sap. Maru, a black dingo whose name signifies his color, has stopped in order to catch his breath. Maru comes from afar, and he will start his trek when the sun has gone down. When the flies are less aggressive. When the sunset will color pearly pink, the skin that a snake in the process of shedding has left behind him. Maru's fur coat is in reality black and tan. Purebred dingoes can be, in effect, clad in ginger, black, black and tan, or white. All other coloration, striped or marble, betrays a deterioration or a hybrid with domestic dogs. The pestilence of the flies has redoubled. Bothered by them, bitten by the ants that draw close to him because of the skin of the serpent, Maru gets up and decides to start out on his trek earlier than he had planned. Around Paraji, no miracle. Shade, freshness, or rain will not happen today. When a dingo or another mammal suffers with serious dehydration, his blood thickens like a porridge. It flows with more and more difficulty in the veins and the arteries, and this state sometimes produces spasms. The capillary vessels congest and no longer permit the internal heat of the body to transfer itself towards the skin, where perspiration can regulate it. A sudden fever takes hold. It can kill. It's what we call sunstroke. On a rocky ground that will facilitate the task for him, an olive python, without a doubt the heaviest serpent of Australia, gets rid of his skin, which he has outgrown. Pythons can shed several times per year. The shedding is set off by a signal sent to the thyroid. The pressure of the blood in the deep layers of the dermis then rises, which provokes the falling of the scaly skin. The skin on the head becomes unattached first. For the rest of the body, the serpent passes and repasses on a ridge of rocks with the intention of letting the rags of his clothing hang there. Snakes shed because their skin, which is covered in scales, possesses neither elasticity nor the power of regeneration. These things would permit them to stretch or increase in size when the animal grows. It must have, therefore, a new skin, and a lighter, more ample one. The old skin that we call exuvie will stay behind in order to prove his passing into another stage of life. Nothing will come to trouble the bath of the superb fairy wren. Peace reigns on Kangaroo Island. Birka and her family seem to want to conform to the ideal image that has been given to their species by the naturalists of the past, or the tales destined for children. Finally reconciled, Yam and his mother Birka embrace tenderly. Kartanya has been approached by Pogo. Nothing has bothered him since Nagama became the head of the family. He keeps watch over her and no longer accepts the presence of other males. Yam, Birka, and Toku that we don't see warm in the pouch of his mother. Nagama, Kartanya, and Pogo. All have shown themselves one by one, angry, jealous, humiliated, clever, or manipulative. The family has been reconstructed in this manner in a few months. We still don't know well the social structure of kangaroos. We believed they were reduced to primary instinctive behaviors. We discover little by little that they are more rich and complex than we had believed. Soon, Birka's pouch can no longer contain Toku. He will then start out on his social life and will mix with the adults. Kartanya, Yam, Toku, and the other children before them, all were born of Burka's blood. In her weighed-down pouch, other babies will still journey. Equipped with a new and shining skin like an armor, many pythons have found themselves on a burning rock. By reason of their volume, the olive python, a cold-blooded animal, takes more time to warm himself than a reptile of lesser size. It prefers, therefore, desert-like and rocky surroundings, where the heat penetrates faster just up to its entrails. Its size also makes the python a terrifying predator that frightens birds, lizards, serpents, and little mammals who are its prey of choice. The python is not venomous, but a constrictor, and that means that its body can wrap around the victim in order to suffocate him. This is why its muscles are so developed. The body has twists and turns, curves, rings in which each loop can transform itself into a trap. The constrictor, the most powerful in Australia, nevertheless produces an attentive mother, who doesn't abandon her eggs after they have hatched, but protects them up until they are formed. The pythons make some moving images on the ground. The heat aiding them, they disentangle and come undone. They brush against one another and assess each other. They are equipped for this, in particular, with two heat-sensitive captors. These organs take the shape of a shaft at each side of the mouth. Soon the olive pythons will start to hunt, at least until a dingo comes to meet them. When their size is big enough in order to deter birds of prey, the dingo becomes their only predator. Artui's herd has now left the savannah, where it has journeyed to a large expanse where everything that can be grazed on has been shaved off, removed, cleared away. Still, at least when each one makes some powdery piles shoot up under their feet, one can bathe oneself in dust. The happiness of the bath rallies all of the troop, the young and the adults, the dominant animals as well as those they dominate. But each one prefers the earth when it has been in certain precise places where they wait their turn, one after the other, to soak up the musk of all the herd. Artui, the chief, takes his part in a pleasure so easy to obtain. At the same time, he rids himself of some parasites in his fur and relieves the irritations of his hide. The camel tolerates the heat as well as the absence of water. In particular, his bodily temperature rises at the same time as the exterior temperature, without a noxious effect, up until 95 degrees. It's at this moment only that the animal starts to perspire, and this delay economizes his water reserves. Conversely, at night, his temperature falls to 80 degrees. When the heat of the day comes, it takes several hours for the dromedary to fill in this difference of 15 degrees. These mechanisms, in a certain way, cushion the thermal variations. In addition, the camel is covered with a woolly thick fur between 2 and 4 inches that fills in like the burnous of the Bedouins, a function of insulation. Finally, the fat of the hump, a poor conductor of heat, makes a screen between the rays of the sun and the body, like a supplementary cover laid on the back. The dust bath has endured long enough. Artui stops the festivities. A latecomer is still in the process of shaking. Artui comes to remind him to come to order and require him to return towards the troop. During this time, other individuals believe they are authorized to rest. Artui will force his fellow camels, one after the other, to respect his law. He knows that life is no longer possible on this corner of the savanna that they have systematically devastated. It is necessary to restart the march and find a greener asylum elsewhere. With the passing weeks, discipline has been loosened. The hierarchical pyramid has lost readability, and each one does their own thing. Artui must re-establish order and bring some insubordinates under control. Finally, the colony takes up the march towards the north, from where there will come one day the fertile rains, and where a little green grass will grow. Artui and his own demand nothing from the desert, for always they content themselves with its promises.